Okay, in this segment, Bob, I'd like to visit with you about considerations for planting corn at this late date.
Okay.
There's a lot of folks that still would like to get some in, and we've seen over the last couple of weeks a significant run-up in the price of corn. So there's a lot of incentive.
Well, you're right, and you know, we could bring in the ag economists and talk another hour just on that whole business.
That's true.
But the key thing at this point that I've been really focusing on is the need to be visiting with seed dealers about the hybrid maturity that you still have left to plant or that you may want to switch to, because corn planted this late begins to run up against the risk of that killing fall freeze. So I've got a newsletter article that walks people through the process of how do you first of all think about hybrids, and it's not about the old days to maturity ratings.
No.
And we've had this discussion over the last couple of days, because all of us typically think about 111 day corn, 110 day corn, etc. When it comes to this kind of decision, it's more about how much heat do they need to mature, and we measure heat in growing degree days. If you look close on your seed tags, almost every company, in addition to saying 110 or 11 day corn, they'll have a number there referring to how many heat units to reach kernel black layer or physiological maturity,
mm-hmm.
and it ranges from 2600, 2700, 2800. That's the number you need to be looking for. And then when you walk through the process that I spell out in my article on how do we work with that number and use some online databases that give us some estimates of GDD accumulations from today until an average fall frost risk, it's a better way to more closely fine-tune that choice of hybrid maturity. Obviously, the people in the north need to be thinking about this sooner than farmers down in southern Indiana because of the differences in growing season. But clearly, now is the time for folks in the northern half of Indiana to be having these discussions with their seed dealer and running through the process that I outlined in my article.
Yeah, and the neat thing about that tool is the producer can actually pinpoint the field
right.
location
right.
on that map.
Right.
So you're going to get as good a data as you possibly
yeah.
can.
Yeah, it's a tool that we just didn't have, you know, maybe up to 5 or so years ago. And it's running off 30-year average accumulations. And it sort of predicts ahead and gives you a sort of a range of, well, if it's turns out to be a cool summer, it could be this few. If it's a warm summer, it could be this many. But again, I'd strongly encourage people to look at that article. We'll put that up on the video here
yeah.
as we edit it. And if you have any questions at all, I tell folks, give me a holler, give me a jingle, and I'll help walk them through.
Well, and the thing about that tool, it's going to say when it reaches maturity.
Right.
But keep in mind what percent moisture you're dealing with, so
yeah.
you
and,
may want to be
and that's
looking.
That's an important point, because you know we can continue growing corn and reach black layer before a killing freeze everywhere in Indiana through almost the end of June, technically. But of course, if you're maturing corn in late October at 30% moisture, we all sort of know how slow it dries in the field after that. So. Some, if because of drying costs, etc., they may want to look for hybrids that'll still mature in late September and give them some time for field dry down. And again, I walk them through that in the process in that article, and you can go that route also.
Right. And isn't it true, Bob, that as we go planting later into the traditional planting season, that those GDDs accumulating
yeah.
are going to narrow down?
Yeah. So for you're exactly right. So for a hybrid that would routinely be characterized as requiring 2,700 GDDs, it might only require 2,500 by the time we get out to the middle of June. It's some sort of a physiological response we don't fully understand, but it's really not important for this situation. The
yeah.
fact is, a hybrid doesn't take as many heat units to mature when you plant this late, so it gives us a little more breathing room
mm-hmm.
to hang on to some of these hybrid maturities longer than we otherwise would.
And seeding rate.
Right.
I mean, you know, Sean's talking about we need
right.
to bump it up. In
right.
corn, we certainly don't.
Yeah, the two crops are different in that respect in terms of how they respond or what you may choose to do with late plantings. For corn, the optimum seeding rate in early June is essentially the same seeding rate as it is back in late April.
Yeah.
If anything, I might reduce seeding rate a couple thousand if I thought my percent stand was going to be better with warmer soils this time
mm-hmm.
of year. But other than that, the economic optimum seeding rate for early June is going to be the same. And based on our research, no more than about 30,000 plants at harvest would be an economic optimum population.
Sure. So, guys, anything we left out?
Well, I think the weed guy needs to speak up here, right? I mean, we got some pretty woolly conditions for your corn, yeah. Right? If you're going to go in the first week of June, second week of June, I mean, how late are you actually going with these switches? Are you thinking middle of June and then cut it off? Or
I have no idea when to cut it off economically, because that's a difficult challenge. Physiologically, we can go almost through the whole month of June. But at some point, yes, you get out to the middle of June, the yield losses that are incurred and the relative difference in them between corn and beans, that plays into that whole difficult thing that we said we couldn't cover in this snippet.
That's where the ag econ guys come
in. Historically, if you look at how our farmers respond in these kind of years, historically, if there are switches made from corn to beans, it tends to happen somewhere in that first or second week of June historically.
So at that point in the season, Bill, I mean, winter annuals, if they haven't been taken care of, is that even an issue? And so think about the corn world, and then now summer annuals come on, what would they do?
Yeah, I think that's an important point. Once we start getting a lot of 80 degree days, most of the time most of our winter annuals will go ahead and set seed, senesce, and die. Two notable exceptions are Marestail, because Marestail is a winter annual. And then sometimes we see fields like we have right here where we have some crest leaf groundsel, and that's the yellow flowered weed out there. Some years when we have really wet conditions like this, even when we have warm weather, that crest leaf groundsel will kind of hang on forever. So occasionally we run into situations where we might need to manage the crest leaf groundsel, but in almost every case, we're going to have to manage the Marestail. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as far as corn production in general and weed competition, we don't like any weed competition in corn whatsoever. It's very sensitive to changes in light, nutrient competition, and all those kinds of things. So we really, regardless of our planting date, we really want to set our corn system up where we're using residual herbicides, we have a minimal amount of early season weed competition, and then when we're planting late like this, if we have to do any post-emergence weed control, the corn is going to go through the growth stages much more rapidly, and we're going to hit those growth stage cutoffs probably 2 or 3 days quicker now than we would have a month ago. So we really need to be thinking about those post-emerge growth stage cutoffs as well.
And the herbicides that'd be most likely to fall in that would be the ones that cut them off around V5 or V6. Would that be true?
There's a few of them that have this V5, V6 cutoff date, yeah. And there's a couple of them that will have a V8 cutoff date, and those are the ones that are most critical to pay attention to.
Yeah, and you know, let's remember, I mean, corn planted late April sometimes takes 3 weeks to emerge. Planted under these warm soils, it'll likely emerge in less than a week, and it's going to reach V5 weeks earlier than you expect it to when you're planting in late April. So staying on top of these fields, scouting, walking, assessing crop growth stage is going to be really important for some of these herbicides.
So then Bill, with that, he wants to plant, you want to spray, what should be done?
My guess would be the best thing to do if you have the right crop genetics where you can spray some broad spectrum post-emerge herbicides, I would put the seed in the ground. Okay. If you're a non-GMO person, I would do as much weed control as possible before that seed comes out of the ground, because you have a more limited number of post-emerge herbicides in non-GMO corn than you do if you're planting Roundup Ready, Liberty Link, or a corn hybrid that has.
And would that likely move you more towards tillage than it otherwise would, in order to get those weeds knocked down? And
yeah, that's a great question. I think when you assess tillage, you have to determine, will one tillage pass take my weeds out, or do I need to till it twice? Mm-hmm. I think on the edges of this field right here, one tillage pass would probably have this ready for planting. Out in this part of the field right here, I would want to do two tillage passes to make sure I get the weeds dislodged, right. I let them dry out a little bit, and then I can till again maybe a day or two later if these weeds are starting to re-root.
So interestingly, in this pass that was made sometime earlier this spring, a lot of those lamb's quarter did not die. They've re-rooted, as you say, because it just never stopped raining and it kept that surface moist. So.
Correct.
Yeah. One other point, Bob. You know, a producer goes through a long evaluation period on what corn hybrids typically to grow.
Right.
So now we're in this compacted rush and challenge to find those hybrids are going to do best at this late planting. So what are some things to think about?
I think probably two key things I'd think about. One is disease resistance to some of the important foliar diseases like gray leaf spot and northern corn leaf blight. Typically, as we move into earlier and earlier maturity hybrids, so maybe 105-day, 100-day corns, often they don't have the same level of disease resistance to those particular diseases as our more adapted full season. And so it takes a little more time to, as you're looking at those 102, 103 day corns, to make sure you're looking for ones that have good levels of those resistance. The other thing I would pay attention to, and this, and the ratings vary one company to another, but sometimes you'll see ratings for how fast it dries down in the fall. And so if you have an opportunity with two hybrids and one is rated as good disease resistance and dries down quickly, I would move towards that hybrid. I'm just trying to hedge bets.
Yeah.
What about starter? I mean, wouldn't starter like get this corn out of the ground faster? And is that something you want to do? Or are you trying to get the planter across the field faster?
Remember, it's going to be out of the ground in 7 days anyway.
Okay.
This late and this warm. And so, you know, getting out, so there isn't that advantage. And Jim Camerato and I have done about 30 starter trials now in the last probably 3 or 4 or 5 years. And among those 30 trials, we've seen a yield response in only about a third of the trials. So that's the one key consideration, is the yield response to starter is not automatic. And so for those people who believe that eliminating starter from the process, planting process, if they believe it's going to gain them significant number of acres per day that they can get under their belt, the risk of yield loss is so minimal, I'd say go ahead, do without it, sure. Just get out there and plant.
And make sure you get the side dress on
and
fairly
then,
timely.
You're right, get side dress timely. There's another response to starter in terms of grain moisture that typically you get a very consistent drier grain with starter, and maybe 1 or 2 points difference in the fall. And so if that economics is important enough to you, then maybe you keep starter in the package. But I think for a lot of people, they could forego the use of row starter, forego the use of in-furrow starter. And if it'll gain them, you know, that many more acres per day, they're going to be ahead. Considering that we're still not yet into a dry period, we're still getting pop-up showers almost every day. You and I were joking yesterday, well, it's about time for the thunderstorm, and it shows up. So.
Okay, thank you.